The Raj Quartet by Paul Scott. Episode 1, The Jewel in the Crown, dramatized by John Harvey.
Dear Auntie Ethel, please forgive me for not having written sooner. I can hardly believe it's a week since we said goodbye in Rawalpindi. The days have flown since I arrived in Mayapur, and looking back, there scarcely seems to have been enough of them to have packed in everything we've done. Today will be my third day on the wards in the hospital, which will show you that no time has been wasted. The train journey was interesting, all the more so for having Aunt Lily with me. She really is extraordinary, isn't she? We had these awful Englishwomen in the carriage with us as far as Lahore, who were absolutely beastly and never said a civil word to either of us. Harpies, Lily called them, drinking and smoking and carrying on as if neither of us existed.
I don't care. The whole thing's a disgrace, sitting there as if she were entitled.
I don't know what this country's coming to.
After all, first class is first class.
As if Lily were not only better educated than any of them, Lady Chatterjee, for heaven's sake, with a history going back generations. And there they are, complaining about having to travel with her because she's Indian. As if it weren't her country.
Daphne, are you coming down? Breakfast is ready.
I get really angry when that kind of thing happens here. Especially when I remember how awful it is back home in London, with no heating on the trains, and the stations all in darkness because of the blackout. Everyone jam-packed, but helping everyone else and trying to be cheerful despite everything. Honestly, Auntie, a lot of white people in India don't know they're born.
Daphne!
So, you slept well?
Yes, Aunt Lily, thank you.
It amuses me when you call me that, Aunt Lily.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to offend you.
Offend? No, no. It is an honour that you feel close enough to call me aunt, as if I were part of your family. Instead of the old mess that I am, with my Rajput blood and my off-white skin and my funny old tongue that is only properly at home in English. You must miss them. Your poor mother especially.
Yes, of course. Though it's been easier to come to terms with losing Mummy somehow. Because I helped nurse her, I suppose. Here in Mayapur, it's Daddy I find I'm thinking about more than ever. And this bloody war that killed him. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to swear.
Oh, that's perfectly all right. You should hear me sometimes with the servants or when I forget some perfectly ordinary thing.
It's just starting here, isn't it? The war. Not even that, really. And all the British who go on about beating the Jap and the Hun, they don't understand. They haven't even heard a rifle fired in anger, most of them, and... Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to go on like that. It's just that I know.
I understand. But please, don't let your tea go cold.
I promised myself I would keep a journal of my time here in Mayapur. Though if today is anything to go by, it will hardly make interesting reading. Practically all of my time at the hospital was spent rolling bandages. Mile after mile of them. And I had to stand to do it. And now my feet are killing me. Thank heavens the boy has just come in to draw my bath. Like the rest of the house, the bathroom, Lily has bequeathed me, is very grand and slightly dotty. Green glazed tiles and a gigantic tub with immense brass taps and webbed claw feet, like those of some dead amphibious monster. To say nothing of a porcelain pedestal mounted on a dais at the far end, which you step up to like someone ascending to the throne. But I must stop writing and start to get ready. Aunt Lily has been invited to dinner at the Deputy Commissioner's and has asked me to go with her. I didn't mean to keep you waiting. I just wasn't sure what would be appropriate. It's not as if I have a great many things to choose from.
You look perfect.
I doubt I ever look that.
Perfectly charming.
And my glasses? Seriously, Auntie, what do you think? Off or on?
You can manage without them.
I'll keep them in my bag, just in case.
You really think it's that serious?
I think the situation will deteriorate, sir.
Deputy Commissioner.
Lady Chatterjee.
I'd like you to meet the niece of my great friend, Lady Manners. Daphne, this is the Deputy Commissioner.
Jack Poulson, Miss Manners. How do you do?
I'm very pleased to meet you.
You know Mr. Merrick, Lady Chatterjee, our new District Superintendent of Police.
Of course.
Lady Chatterjee, Miss Manners.
We were just talking about the way things are going, politically, I mean. The divisions between the Indian Congress Party and the Muslim League. Mr. Merrick is of the opinion the situation may get worse before it gets better.
I'm afraid so.
Let us hope, Mr. Merrick, that is not the case.
Indeed. So, Miss Manners, what brings you to this neck of the woods?
I'm a volunteer at the hospital. Mm.
Really?
Yes. I came in from England to stay with my aunt in Rawalpindi, and she suggested I might come here for a while and stay with Lily, Lady Chatterjee. But I wanted to do something useful, so I help out on the wards. As much as the matron will allow me. There always seems to be a great deal to do.
Not where I live, well, anyway.
Lady Chatterjee, of course, lives out at the old McGregor house. Yes. Extraordinary place.
Ah.
Isn't there some story behind it, Lady Chatterjee? Something rather fanciful, as I recall.
There are many. But this is the one that I believe. The original was built by a prince in the 18th century. Not for himself, but for a woman he was enamored with, a singer. The story is that he would visit her each morning and evening, and she would sing to him. And when she died, he grieved so much that he died of a broken heart.
Do you really believe that such a thing is possible?
To die of a broken heart? Yes, I do. And you know, the songs she used to sing to him, if you listen carefully, you can still hear them.
You mean the place is haunted?
If that's the word you choose.
After the prince died, Lady Chatterjee, what happened then?
Ah, then the house fell into decay and was rebuilt 100 years ago by a red-faced Scottish nabob called MacGregor, who feared God and favoured Muslims, and whose wealth came, it was rumoured, from bribery.
And this MacGregor, did he too die of a broken heart?
No. He was murdered by mutinous sepoys in the wake of the massacre of Amritsar.
I see.
His wife was killed also. She was only young. She appears sometimes on the veranda, dressed in the fashion of the times and swaying to and fro, as if nursing her dead baby, though there is nothing in her arms.
Oh, Auntie.
There is blood on her torn bodice. Her name is Janet. Janet MacGregor. A Muslim servant died defending her.
I hope you weren't too bored.
Not at all.
It's true it wasn't quite as dull as usual. At least not until the men withdrew and we were left to woman chatter over coffee.
I didn't think it was so bad.
I was hoping Anna Klaus would be there.
Dr. Klaus?
Yes. She's a good friend of mine. I expect you've met her at the hospital.
I've only seen her so far. And then at a distance, she always seems so busy.
Dedicated, that's Anna. After working a full day at the hospital, often she'll go and help out Sister Ludmilla at the sanctuary.
The sanctuary?
Yes, it's a refuge for the sick and dying. The sister runs it almost single-handed.
It's attached to the church, then? Some kind of religious charity?
Oh, no. As far as I can tell, Sister Ludmilla isn't a nun at all. Some say she's related to the Romanovs, others that she's been a Hungarian peasant, a Russian spy, a German adventuress, or a runaway French novice.
How extraordinary!
Whatever the truth of it, each day she ministers to the sick, and each evening she goes out into the street with her assistant and some stretcher bearers to separate the dying from the dead.
Here! Over here!
There!
Here! In the ditch!
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.